Okay, church, honesty question here. How many of you are aware that sometimes you can be annoying to other people? Show of hands. Okay, most of you. That's awesome. That is awesome. If you didn't raise your hand, it's because it's you. Okay. Now, I'm annoying to some people. Don't say amen. Too late. Thank you. But listen, what's the time I was annoying? Well, I remember I was on a flight. I used to do a lot more flying a few years back, and I was on a flight. Have you ever been on a flight watching someone else's movie way too long? Have you done that? Isn't that like the best? It's like you're cheating. You know something's wrong. You're like, I'm cheating. This is wrong. I have a screen right in front of me, but I'm more drawn in to where Frozen is in the movie Frozen. I was watching Frozen for like 20 minutes on some guy's screen. And before I figured out, wait a minute, this isn't right. But then I could have watched it right in front of me, but I was too far invested into his screen. Have you done this? And then you're like, I need to know what the next part is, right? So you just keep watching it until he turned around and he glared at me. And I remember just smiling, and then he glared back, and I was like, do I have to stop now? We've already had this thing, and the opposition's already been dealt with. So I'll just deal with the glare again. Well, Jesus had quite a few annoying people in his time. People that you think, okay, wow, he just slammed that guy. There's no way that guy's getting up. And sure enough, a chapter later, here he comes again. Jesus dealt with annoying people. And if it wasn't the religious people of the day or the legally astute people of the day, it was his own disciples. And in this passage, you're going to see a combination of people that annoy Jesus. Now, let's recall. Sometimes it's good when you keep going through a book to just pause and go, why are we here and what are we learning? The theme of the book of Matthew, if you're a note taker, and I would encourage you to do that, is Jesus is King. That's the theme of the book. And as we've seen, chapters 1 through 10 is about the revelation of Jesus the person, who he is. Chapters 11 through 13 are about the rebellion against Jesus the King. And then as we hit chapters 14 through 20, this is really the retreat of the king. And what Jesus is going to do from chapters 14 through 20 is he sort of pulls back from the crowds with his disciples to get away to teach them some instruction and some discipleship-oriented things that will last through their life and ministry. But that does not mean that he is, if you will, without annoyances and annoying people, as we're going to see today. But as he's retreating, he's still dealing with these people that are chasing him, that will annoy him and follow him throughout the book of Matthew, all the way through to his death on the cross and his resurrection. And so here we see him retreating, and we're going to deal with three things today we want to talk about. Number one is sign seeking. Number two is leaven leaking. I couldn't think of a better way, and it rhymes, so why not? And then the last one is the sign of Jonah. So the first one, sign seeking, check out verse 1. Then the Pharisees and Sadducees came and tested him, asked him that he would show them a sign from heaven. So we know this, but first off, you have two groups. You have the Pharisees, of course. They were the religious traditionalists of the day. And then you have the Sadducees, who really were these liberal people. And you could say that the Pharisees were like the legalists, and the Sadducees were the liberalists. You had two extremes. You have the same tension today as you did back then in Scripture. It came at it a little bit different, but this is what you have, these two parties that primarily can only agree on one thing, and that is that they hate Jesus. And so they will follow him in opposition and annoyance all the way now to the end. And it's amazing because these guys historically, listen, they could not stand each other. Church, the only thing Pharisees and Sadducees had in common was white robes. That's literally it, other than they're annoying at the same time. And maybe you found this in your own life. You've met people on one extreme or the other. You have legalists that literally have a legal list of right or wrong when you're around them. You always feel you're not good enough, and they'll always tell you you're not good enough religiously. And then you have liberalists. You have people that in the name of God say, look, you know, let's not take the Bible literal. And, you know, we would call this like the emergent church today. The Old Testament's more of a story. Yeah, man, it's not really meant to be taken literally. And let's just calm down. And the liberalists, of course, liberal leads to licentious. And of course, licentious leads to the lust of the flesh. Where you just go, since it doesn't really matter, who cares if I go out and get drunk or smoke drugs or whatever the thing is. The liberal life, it just leads away from God. But here, in the name of God, you have these two camps saying, we represent God. Now, it's not a lot different today. And even though they don't share anything in common in their beliefs, they share one thing in common, and that is that they hate Jesus. So the two of them have completely different beliefs in each of their parties, but because they hate another party, well, then they are joined together. Starting to sound like Canadian politics. Sorry, guys. Now, hate makes strange bedfellows, as the saying goes. And so now you've maybe heard of the term, the enemy of my enemy, fill in the blank, is my friend. So these two groups now get together for the first time in chapter 16, and they'll stay throughout the book of Matthew hating Jesus together. And it says, and testing him, they asked if he would show them a sign from heaven. First off, when you see these words, hey, Jesus, show us a sign from heaven. Does that hit anybody as a little unusual at this point in our account in the scripture? Not if you know what I'm talking about. What have we just left? What was last week? Shout it out. Anybody? Come on now. Feeding the 4,000. Not to mention that right before the feeding of the 4,000, okay, which is really the miracle of the loaves and fishes part two, the sequel. Just before that, they had part one, the feeding of the 5,000. And sandwiching those two mighty miracles, you have Jesus doing what? Healing the sick, the lame, the maimed, enabling blind people to see, the paralytic to walk. So is it just me, or it's just on a first read this week when I'm reading this, I'm going, what? Didn't you guys just see all this stuff that Jesus did? Yet you come and you're like, hey, Jesus, I would like a sign. Can you do a sign for us? Could you do something now, oh, like a sign? Yeah, because we haven't had that. Parents, some of you understand this. This is similar to right after you feed your kids supper and they're like, I'm hungry. Anybody had that? Come on, who's got kids? You know what I'm talking about, right? They're like, I'm hungry. And then they go to the fridge. You're like, what are you doing? If you're hungry, have more of the healthy food we just made. But as we all know, they don't really want the healthy food, and neither do these guys, but this is the situation that comes up to this chapter. And it's amazing how people are like this with the Lord. All he's done in their life, all he's done in history. Even stuff that empirically we can prove. We know the history of the cross. The empty tomb is the most historically accurate event ever in history. And I have two sermons on that if you want to listen to them or watch them. The fact that he rose from the grave and that he said he would and that it was witnessed and then witnessed by over 500 and then so many of the opponents to his literal resurrection get saved. And then through history, all these people that go after his resurrection got saved trying to disprove it. The evidence is astounding for the resurrection. Jesus is alive. And here comes these guys, and they're like, I need more. I need more evidence. I mean, through history, we have evidence, not just of the resurrection. We have all the miracles produced, all the healings, all the positive upturn, and even countries affected by the gospel and groups turning to Jesus, peace and love. Reading a book right now just on the history of the Bible and how it's positively affected time and history. Even prophecy itself, the fact that no ancient writing or holy book comes anywhere near to the Bible in historical prophetic fulfillment. Even the life of Jesus, over 400 prophecies, all fulfilled in one man's life, the God-man Jesus, so that we are, as the Bible says, without excuse. And yet, we need more. And you know this, and so do I. So sad that today people have less evidence for certain beliefs that they'll buy into than they do for Jesus, but they just accept them. Why is that? You get to this passage and you kind of go, what is with these guys? Didn't they see it all? How come they don't believe with everything in front of them? But you know this, because it's not just these guys, it's someone in your life. It's a neighbor, it's a family member, it's someone you shared Jesus with. You think, man, I've laid out all the evidence, but they're still not turning. Well, 2 Corinthians 3:14 tells us that Satan has put a blindfold over the eyes of non-believers and those who willingly reject the gospel. If a person desires to see the light and know the truth, then friends, I promise you, if someone gets that inside of them, they will find the truth. Jeremiah 29 prophesies that if you seek me with all your heart, you will be found by him. But until that happens, church, the Bible says there's a blindness placed over the eyes of non-believers. And that's super helpful to remember and to understand that there is not just this sort of, I gave you the evidence, can't you see the facts? Don't you believe, uncle, whatever his name is, this Christmas when you're sharing Jesus with someone? But you have to remember that there's a blindness over them that's spiritual that has to be pierced. And that blindness will stay on them until they have that desire to seek the Lord. I read this week about a French woman who lived over 60 years ago and had been blind from birth. One day someone gave her the Gospel of Mark in Braille. And she was so blessed by the account of Jesus that she read it over and over, listen to this church, until her fingertips became calloused and lost their sensitivity. To regain feeling in her fingers, she cut off the calluses and with bloody fingertips read Mark's gospel yet again. And as she continued to cut away the skin and the calluses, however, she damaged her nerve endings so badly that soon she lost all feeling in her fingertips and couldn't read anymore. Devastated, she held her copy of the Gospel of Mark in her hands one last time and literally kissed it goodbye. It was then she discovered, and I Googled this because I also found there's a lady in China right now doing the same thing, reading the Bible just 6 years ago in 2013. If you Google it, the same thing happened to her in a way. She discovered her lips were more sensitive than her fingertips ever had been. And so she continued to study the scripture, listen to this, with her lips, and went on to become a gifted teacher of the word of God. Those who are blind, friends, but want to see, will see, regardless of whatever's in front of them, regardless of whatever is attacking them or pushing back against them. But I promise you, those who don't want to see, and you know this in your own life, it doesn't matter how much evidence you give someone. It doesn't matter how much apologetics you give someone. It's still a choice of faith. And I say that because I have some good friends that are doing really well in apologetics. Some of you guys know them. You've met them. We brought them here. Charlie Campbell, JoJo Rubin, some other guys, Andy Bannister. But they will all gladly admit to you that you can have the greatest argument, but until that person is moved by faith, you won't see the blindness go away. And that's really important. Why? Because you're going to get frustrated sometimes when you're sharing your faith with someone and you're like, I don't understand. I told them everything. I gave them all the evidence. But you have to know this. It's faith that will move them to salvation. No matter how good your argument is, nobody's saved by an argument. They might be convinced here, but it has to be in the heart that faith is produced. Remember, Jesus couldn't go into a certain area because he said, he couldn't do any miracles there because he said of their unbelief. And the same thing happens with our friends and family members. Until belief is found in them, you won't see them set free from the darkness. Now, this is kind of a big deal. These guys don't want to see, and that's why they're missing it. And you're going to find that this is one of those frustrating things in your life when something's right in front of you. Here's how Jesus answers. It's a lot different than probably you or I would answer. Look what he says, verse 2. He said to them, when it's evening, you say it'll be fair weather, for the sky is red, and in the morning it will be foul weather today, for the sky is red and threatening. Hypocrites. You know how to discern the face of the sky, but you can't discern the signs of the time. Okay, church, help me out. Red sky in the morning, red sky at night, Is it sailor? Is there a shepherd version as well? Hands up if someone thinks it's shepherd. Okay, good. That's wrong if you think that. It's definitely sailor. I didn't Google it. I thought I'd just ask you live. Why not? You did pretty good. Well, this term, we go, oh, we know that saying, Joel. Come on, that's from our, we've grew up with that too. Well, actually, this term is kind of cool because it goes way, way back. It's one of the earliest writings. If you go to the British Museum in England, this term that Jesus quotes here is on the Rosetta Stone. You'll actually, you can follow the history of it. It goes all the way back to that. And it's a term from the day that Jesus is reminding them of when you see the red sky in the morning. Hey, there's a warning here. How many of you saw the red sky warning us? I don't know, it was like 7 days or a week, 10 days ago, right before the massive storm. Did you see that? I did. And then I came out and I thought rabid squirrels had attacked my barbecue. Because literally the barbecue cover was like ripped to shreds, and I thought, I knew it. And but turns out it was just a storm. Well, Jesus says, speaking of the heavens, you can predict the heavenly signs. Why not the signs of the times? You guys have no problem going, hey, look at the sky. Well, that means tomorrow the weather's going to be this way. Right? We don't have to worry about that now because we have weather people that tell us wrongly what the weather's going to be tomorrow. But back then, they knew how to read the signs. They're probably better off than we were, but anyway. Well, Jesus says, look, why not the signs of the times? How come you're asking me for a sign when all of these signs, I mean, of all the people, think about the judgment in this statement, of all the people that should know the signs of the times, do you think the guys that were like, oh, you know what, we'll take the law, thank you, Moses, and we'll set up our own law, 600 plus laws, and we'll be the ones that read it, we'll be the ones that convey it to Israel. Can you imagine? These are the ones that he saves his harshest words for. You guys study this stuff day and night, yet you don't even know. You don't even know when I'm going to show up for the first time. You missed it in your own Bibles, the prophecy of my first coming. And that's exactly true. Daniel prophesied precisely when the Messiah would be on the scene in chapter 9. It says 490 years from a certain day. Nehemiah chapter 2 tells us it's March 14th, 445 BC. The commandments given by Artaxerxes, the prophecy of Nehemiah 2 and Daniel 9. And when you add them together, 483 years later, exactly on the day, April 6, 32 AD, Jesus comes to the Mount of Olives. And he weeps over Jerusalem. Then as he comes down the Mount of Olives in Israel, we start at the top of Mount of Olives. When we get to Jerusalem, we go down. And the people start doing what? They start throwing branches in front of him, palm branches. And they start shouting out what word? Anybody know? Hosanna. 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 And they start shouting out, they're saying, you're our Messiah. And he entered on exactly April 6, 32 AD. Some of you say, well, you said 490 years, that's 483. Well, that's because the last 7 years of prophecy, if you believe this, and I do, of world history is yet to be fulfilled. So it's a message to these guys. Look, you missed me at my first coming, but it's a message to us. Don't miss me at my second coming. There's still a seven-year period to be fulfilled. For 2,000 years, the church has been under the grace of God. And then in a moment, the trump will sound. And when Paul first got to Thessalonica, this is the first thing he taught the church in Thessalonians. He's like, don't freak out because you're all getting persecuted. Because guess what? There's coming a future day when the trump will sound and you'll all be harpazoed. You'll be sucked up, caught up to meet the Lord in the air, raptured. And he says, take great comfort in these things. Guys, look at what is happening on planet Earth today. Ezekiel, the prophet, says right before the return of Jesus, all the nations will be gathered around Israel. It's exactly what's happening right now on planet Earth. They're all in Syria, all the nations of Ezekiel 38. And Jesus is saying, can't you discern the sign of the times? Don't you know prophecy? Don't you know that there was a day that I would be coming? There's an exact day that I would be coming, and your own prophets told you this. And he's like, do you really need another feeding? Do you need like part three? Like we did 5,004, maybe we need seven. Some of you be convinced if 7,000 people got bread. And Jesus is like, I'm right in front of you. And he says, you can't even see the signs. And I believe to this generation and to us, church, he's saying the same thing. I'm right here. I'm right here. I'm your soon coming king, but I'm also right here in front of you today. And how often aren't you aware of this? That we're asking for more evidence of his love in our life. We're asking for more. Lord, would you just confirm this and confirm this? And he goes, I have my word. I have the testimony of Jesus. I have the testimony of prophecy, of the cross, of everything I told you would happen that is happening. You only need me right in front of you. Here I am. I'm available. And I'm soon coming. Look at verse 4. Here's how he responds to that approach that is like more evidence. Look what he says. A wicked and adulterous generation seeks after a sign. No sign shall be given them except the sign of the prophet Jonah. And he left them and departed. Why is sign seeking so bad? We all do it, don't we? We're like, well, you know, I'm praying about a job. And so I'm just kind of asking for a sign, you know, kind of. You know, is that the same as what these guys are doing, right? And then you hear different versions. Somebody is like, well, I'm throwing out a fleece, and another Christian will jump in and go, shouldn't throw out a fleece. That's a lack of faith, right? We're like, you're looking for a sign. Just trust the Lord. What's the balance here? I mean, is it adultery to ask for more evidence? Well, first off, let's just deal with this. I think some people really believe that miracles are all that's needed to convince someone, but that is simply not true. If that were the case, Jesus could just take, you know, right in the clouds, Jesus is real in fire, and everyone would be convinced, right? The answer is no. Look, Pharaoh and his armies weren't convinced, were they, with the separating of the Red Sea? There was no, like, Pharaoh going, whoa, time out, everybody stop. Time out, the water separated, no chance we're going through there. Clearly, this is a God thing. How about the cloud of fire? How about the pillar and the cloud? Wouldn't that be enough? What about all the plagues on the land? Wouldn't that be enough? Miracles, guys, don't convince people, or they might for a short time, but they certainly don't convert people. They satisfy a person's curiosity. Oh, that's nice. But they don't bring someone into born-again salvation. They don't. And often, they don't even convince a person. Otherwise, you'd see all these people through scriptures go, oh, wow, okay, good, we believe. But that's not the case. Because of the hardness of hearts, people will not believe even if something cool happens. So we like miracles. We like God doing something. And you pray at the front for someone here. And this happens often. They come up, they get prayed for. And then guess what? We had this just 2 weeks ago. We prayed for someone. They went to the doctor, got a test, found out there was nothing wrong. And I go, well, that's because God healed you. We're not weird about it. We don't name it and claim it. It's not like come forward and everyone I touch with my left hand specifically. No, that's false teaching. But we still believe that God heals and changes lives and does things because God is God and he's able. It's not hard for him. It's hard for us. But what Jesus is after is faith and trust. We always want proof. He says, trust me. Maybe you're looking, if you're really honest, maybe you're looking for a sign right now. Your marriage, your career. Maybe it's your relationship. It's really difficult. Maybe it's a family member. You're like, oh, I need a sign, Lord. Maybe it's your future. Maybe it's your spouse. Hey, for some of you, maybe it's your future spouse. And you're like, show me a sign, Lord. Well, what's so wrong with sign seeking like that? Well, let me illustrate. In North Carolina, my wife and I, right after we got married, went to North Carolina. We served at a church there for about 4 years. And towards the end, I felt like God was stirring my heart to come back to Canada. And so it's a combination of God stirring my heart and my wife saying, I want to go back to Canada. The combination was pretty convincing. Just put Canadian music in the background all the time. And so one day it was getting pretty serious. I was like, oh, this is it, Lord. Lord, I'm not really sure what's going on. So I went for a jog. And I literally remember running along and praying the words, Lord, show me a sign. Guess what verse God spoke to my heart right then? An adulterous generation seeks a sign. While I was running, I'm like, go, oh, okay, all right, never mind. Don't show me a sign, Lord. And then I'm like, okay, if not a sign, what am I supposed to do? And I felt ever so clear, and maybe this is for someone here, God speak to my heart and say, don't seek a sign, sense a leading. Sense a leading. Because I lead my people by faith. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. So get back into my word and you'll get it in your quiet times with me. And that's exactly what happened. And maybe you need to hear that today. Guys, wisdom is a long guidance in the same direction. If you're praying about something and you're all locked up in your mind, I need a sign. You actually probably just need to look at what he speaks through his word in the morning. It's funny how many times we come back to that. You're always like, give me the nugget. The nugget is this, spend time with Jesus in his word and ask him to lead you. Is that so true? We always want some new thing, like, okay, Joel, what's the zinger? Here's the zinger. Spend time in the word. Get filled with faith and trust and walk. The world says, if I can see it, then I'll believe it. God's answer is always, if you believe it, then you'll see it. Whether it's initial faith or ongoing faith. And the problem, church, is that often we don't treat Jesus like the one who loves our soul, like the one who is singularly passionate about us more than anyone else, who wants to guide our lives, who is just so in love with us. And we can often get into this place where rather than seeing him as the lover of our soul, he's more like a genie in a bottle. Okay, Lord, which way? Left or right? I'm rubbing the bottle here. I got my Bible out. And you want to ask the question, what is the purpose of coming to the Lord? For these guys, we know John 6 tells us. They sought him for the bread, John 6 says. They didn't actually seek Jesus. Listen to this, church. They didn't seek Jesus for who he is, but what he would do for them. Did you hear that? They sought Jesus for what he would do for them. Well, I'm here in church. Now would you do stuff for me because I've done my part of the bargain. I'm attending, Lord. That's the contractual relationship. And Jesus wanted them, and he wants us to seek him, not just for direction, but for relationship. It's a beautiful thing. Are you coming to Jesus in this season as your personal genie or the guiding person in your life, the steering wheel of your life? Are you seeking him for a sign or for who he is? For his ability to help you get what you want, or that he's your father and he loves you and knows what's best? Number two, leaven-leaking. Look at verse 5. When his disciples had come to the other side, they'd forgotten to take bread. This is funny. Then Jesus said to them, take heed and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And they reasoned among themselves, saying, it's because we've taken no bread. So that's just a great chunk of scripture, isn't it? I mean, because you know these guys, because you would have done the same thing, right? I mean, they had the feeding of the 5,000, and they were freaking out, and they came out of it with 12 baskets, and everybody's celebrating these 12 leftover baskets of bread. They clearly carried them with them, probably. And they're all celebrating. And then the feeding of the 4,000. And the Bible says there's 7 baskets left over, but they're not the little baskets from the other one. It's a different word. They're these giant hampers. Now they've got these giant hampers of bread. And then a few verses later, Jesus is like, hey, watch out for the leaven. That's an evil word in the Jewish language. It's the stuff that goes in and permeates the bread. And he says, watch out for the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And they're like, oh no, he's ticked about the bread. Who brought the bread? Peter, where's the bread? Left it on the boat. Where's the boat? There. Right? This is that moment. And I think they're celebrating this thing. It's just my own theory. I didn't read it anywhere. I think it's like the, you know, like when Toronto won the NBA trophy. They've got it up. They're like celebrating it. Did you know the Stanley Cup, by the way, is like the most fumbled and lost cup of any major sport in the world? Anybody know this? I mean, there's some really funny stories. One team won the Stanley Cup. It's a bit of a rabbit trail, but it's fun. One team won, it's called sickness. One team won the Stanley Cup. They took it home to one of the players' teams for a big meal. The mom made a big meal for them. Then she used it as a potting pot and put plants in it. They couldn't find it for the longest while. And it's like, oh, it's Johnson's mom has it as a holding plants in it. She's like, what? I thought it was a nice pot. Anyway. Another one, these guys got pulled over, and they ran out of gas on the side of the road, and they empty out, or You know what? I'm misquoting. That was a different one. On this one, the tire broke, so they got out, and they're like, we can't leave Stanley in the car, so they put it on the side of the road, changed the tire, got back in and drove off and left Stanley on the side of the road. It's amazing. So I don't know why reference that. I think maybe this is what's going on here. I think these guys are like partying hard. They're like, he did it again. First 12 baskets and now 7 hampers. He's the man. This is awesome. We're with Jesus. They celebrate into the night, eating, their faces full of bread, a little different than today's teams, but and then they leave the baskets of bread. So this is what's on their mind. And Jesus now uses a bread illustration, and they reason, look at verse 7, among themselves, saying, it's because we've taken no bread for the trip. Right? This is that stupid, right? But he's not talking about that. He's worried not about bread, of course. He's worried about the leaven of the Pharisees, the leaven of the Sadducees. And he is warning them of legalism and liberalism seeping into their lives and seeping into the church. You know, I don't know if you've noticed, you'd kind of have to have your head in a hole if you didn't, but last couple weeks have been interesting because you see the two camps of the Christian faith, legalism and liberalism, come out strong in the last 2 weeks. Of course, you know this. Who knows? You know, well, no, I just told you, if you don't know, your head's in a hole, so let's not do the show of hands. But you've heard of Kanye West, and you know that this artist has professed salvation in Jesus. And it's funny, and everybody's attuned now. You're like, well, what do you think? What do you think? And I got asked quite a bit online, what do you think about this? Can you comment on this? Well, I would just say this. There's always two extremes. The legalist comes out right away and goes, well, he's not saved. Look at his lifestyle. Look at the clothing he wears. He swore on some previous albums, you know, and this, this, and this, and this. The liberalist goes, hey, who cares, man? He says he's saved. I'm cool with that. Whatever, live and let live. But somewhere in the middle, I think there's some balance. One is, when someone professes Jesus, church, shouldn't we be praying that it is real? Shouldn't we be asking God to make it real if for some reason it's not? Two is, shouldn't we have hope that someone in a place like this is saved? I mean, shouldn't we go, man, is God able to save this guy? Look, if he can save you, he can save him, can't he? If he can save me, he can save Kanye. That's another thing. And then also, you know, like, okay, I respect, listen, Jesus said, you'll know them by their fruit. So here's what I would say to you, to the people on the, maybe on the too far liberalist, sort of like, oh, who cares, man? Live and let live. Listen, fruit, what do we know about fruit? Fruit takes time to grow. So you're not going to know right away, but we shouldn't want for someone not to be saved. They could be used in mighty ways for the gospel. But over time, we find out. But we should be praying. I'm like, well, I'm pretty impressed that the first album he released is called Jesus is King. The theme of Matthew. It's like he knew my sermon was coming up on this. I was impressed. I was like, I sent him a text on that one. Thanks, bro. But I'm listening to the songs on that sermon at the gym this week on the treadmill. One of them is, he's saying, like, right after I got saved, the greatest opposition I got was from who? It's in his song. He said, Christians. I thought, man, that grieves my heart, whether you're saved or not. Shouldn't the greatest love come from Christians? Why is it that the legalist in us, and I do it too, right away wants to judge people rather than go, let's pray for them. I'll tell you what it is. It's fear, and it's a sense of a lack of control. What if he isn't saved, and then he starts, you know, saying all these things, and then our kids will follow that, and it's like, calm down. Calm down. I'm pretty sure the fear in the Christian community was larger at the time Paul got saved than Kanye. Do you know what I'm saying? Saul got saved. No, no chance. Not a chance. That guy kills Christians. There's no way he's saved. Well, he's saved. He's preaching Jesus all over Jerusalem. Well, somebody needs to stop that because that's ridiculous. We are not associating with the guy. He's a killer of Christians. I don't think there's anyone worse than that. So I just say to you, pray for the guy. Pray for his family. And other people are like, well, if he is saved, then why would Kim Kardashian wear what he wears? Look, if he is saved, he just got saved. Give him some time. And if he is saved, there's no guarantee his whole family's saved. Sometimes in the Bible, the whole family gets saved. Sometimes it doesn't. What should you do? Pray for them. but lower the legalism a bit. And add, don't go liberal, but go love. Go love. What is the greatest thing, church, that solves legalism in your life? Grace. What's the doctrine that counters legalism? Grace. What's the doctrine that counters liberalism? Holiness. I'm just making this up. Sounds good, though. I think it is. I think it's holiness. Personal holiness? Both. Holiness as you look upon the holiness of God and holiness as you work out holiness. Paul said, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. But then he also says, for it is Christ who works in you. So like, lay down the go. We want to be a church, do we not? Where anyone can come in here and the first thing they get from us is love, not legalism. Could you believe what that person's wearing? Do we really want to be that way? I don't see Jesus ever that way. I mean, honestly, even these guys, they're like, show us a sign. I can just tell you, the legalist in my heart, because you have it too, and so do I, would have been like, oh, I'll give you a sign, all right. Here's your sign. I would have hit them with the baskets of bread, because I'm so done with these guys already, but not our Jesus. He's not done. He's like, ah, you guys, all right. I'll call you hypocrites, but I'm not going to end the relationship. Verse 8, Jesus, being aware of it, said to them, oh, you of little faith. By the way, this is comical. The most common phrase Jesus uses of the disciples. We always love to go, oh, the disciples are the saints, the holy saints. Did you know that Jesus' favorite term for the disciples? Oh, you of little faith. That's the one. Why do you reason among yourselves? Because you've brought no bread. Do you not understand or remember the 5 loaves of the 5,000 and how many baskets you took up, nor the 7 loaves of the 4,000 and how many large baskets you took up? How is it you don't understand that I did not speak to you concerning bread? And all of us have this sort of collective, duh, because we're the same. These guys are stuck on the bread they don't have, yet they forget the Jesus that they do have in front of them, who's the bread maker. I mean, there's no greater bread maker in the history of the world than Jesus, right? And they're like, we have no bread, but you're with Jesus who just fed 4,000 plus husbands and wives and children, and then 5,000 before that. He's mad because we have no bread. I would assume that they would have got that bread's not an issue for him. I mean, how many times, right? And sometimes we do this. We forget what God has done. And we're still in want of something he just did around the corner in our life. We're like, Lord, how are you going to give me rent money? And it's like 2 months ago, he gave you rent money. And so Jesus uses this embarrassing event, as he does in our lives too, as an occasion to teach an important spiritual truth. Verse 11, beware the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Then they understood that he didn't tell them to beware, this is a great line, of the leaven of bread, but of the doctrine of the Pharisees and Sadducees. Light bulb. And here's the warning. Here's the warning. Leaven leaking in your life will always lead to disaster. I'll say it again. Leaven leaking in your life will always lead to disaster. Here's the thing about false doctrine in your life, whether it's legalist or liberalist. It never comes all at one time. It's very soft in the way it permeates. Liberalism in your life is where things start to get a little loosey-goosey, out of control, and things that were formerly just like maybe a bad habit is now a rampant sin, but it doesn't happen overnight. It happens slowly. You maybe for fun did an online poker game, or the plane did a stop down in Vegas, and you're like, let's get off and drop 10 bucks in the slot machines, and you think, oh, no harm, no harm, but then now you're drawn, and then you do it a little more, and next thing you know, you have a gambling problem. It doesn't happen to everybody, but it happens to somebody. You started out, you had a video game that you were kind of into, but now it's like you'd rather play your game than be with your family. You always have to watch your affections, church. The Bible talks a lot about our affections betraying us. Your habits, your decisions that start small, then over time. You see a guy miss church once, defend it the next time you see him, and you're like, I don't get points for attendance. Next thing you know, he's gone twice a month. Then he's gone whole months at a time. And he doesn't realize that it's him that's hurting. We are hurting that they're not with us, but we see what happens in a life, like the Bible says, that is away from consistent fellowship. It damages them. And so habits make or break you. You have to be careful of liberal living, but also legal living. I tweeted out this week, the challenge of modern discernment ministries is they run the risk of becoming the ancient Pharisees. I love that we have discernment ministries. I have quite a few friends in discernment ministries, and I praise God for them. But the modern discernment ministries are turning a lot of them, not all of them, but a lot of them are turning, guys. You know, I hope you know this, and you can always ask me about this. This is a favorite pet peeve. If you ever want a coffee on this, just look me up, because honestly, there's some discernment ministries out there that are kind of like under the guise of being a Berean and searching the scripture. They're actually searching the internet more than they're searching the scripture, and they're shooting arrows at so many Christians. And even when someone puts a foot slightly wrong, they'll be like, false teacher, when they're not a false teacher, and it causes so much damage. Remember, the grace of God. The grace of God deals with legalism. So not sign-seeking, nor liberalism, nor legalism, then where should our focus be? And we'll close with this as the worship team comes up. Jump back to verse 4 as we close. I want to just point out what Jesus gives as an antidote to all this way of living and thinking. He says, look at the end of verse 4, and no sign shall be given them except the sign of the prophet Jonah. Here's Jesus' solution. Are you ready? You want a sign? I'll give you one. Jonah. Remember Jonah's story? Remember what happened to Jonah? Right? He's thrown overboard because this massive storm comes on the ship. And they're all freaking out, and they figure out, they have the spiritual presence enough to go, something's wrong, someone on the ship is sinning, who is it? And they find Jonah, and he's sleeping in the bottom of the ship, and he goes, yep, the problem's me, throw me overboard, the problem will end. That's brave. And so they throw him overboard, and probably Jonah in his mind was like, you know, I'll swim for a bit, then I'll just drown, because I am not going where? To Nineveh. Nineveh's this town that he didn't, listen to this, he didn't want to see get saved. Crazy, right? That's legalism. It's like, well, it has to be on my terms that they get saved. They're not saved unless I say they're saved, and certainly that person can't be saved. Sound familiar? Legalism. So Jonah's like, I'm not going. So what does God do? Sends a great fish, swallow him up. 3 days he's in the belly of the whale. Finally he's broken. Such a great book. He starts crying out to God. He's praying from the belly of this great fish. And then what does God do? He just kind of tells the fish, okay, it's 3 days now, 3 nights. Okay, spit him on land. So he spits him on land, and Jonah, it's really the best, shortest sermon ever preached at an evangelistic crusade, walks into town smelling like a fish, looking like a fish, gets up there. He's just like this horrible looking preacher, gets up and he's like, repent or you're going to get struck. Basically, that's his message. Repent or you're all going to die. And then the Bible basically tells us he goes up to a hill and sits there to watch the fireworks. He's like, okay, they're not going to repent. So, okay, God, show me the fireworks. So he does. He's like, send them down. Let's see it. But instead what happens, the king goes, oh my goodness, we are wicked. We need to turn from our wickedness to God. The grace of God comes upon an entire city. The grace of God, in spite of a legalist, hits an entire city, saves them all. Much to Jonah's dismay, they're all saved. Because the grace of God is the most powerful thing. And this entire city goes through a total revival because somebody that was just more willing to sit there with his arms folded and judge than he was to just believe God for amazing things. The power of the grace of God. And Jesus goes, if you want a sign, look at Jonah. Jonah was in the ground. 3 days, 3 nights. He was in the fish. 3 days, 3 nights. I was in the ground. 3 days, 3 nights. Then Jonah came gloriously
out of the fish and I came out of the ground. That's the sign. The sign is always the fact that I've conquered Satan, sin, death, demons, the grave, and hell, and I have risen victorious, and I am your soon coming king. The sign is that I'm still in the ministry, still in the business of saving lost people who we would say, they're Nineveh to me. Get them out of here. No way that guy can be saved. God goes, that's the one I'm going to save just to mess you up. I don't know if Kanye West is saved, but I'll tell you what, Nineveh was saved. And Saul was saved. Let me just throw another one in here. Ready? And for some of you in this room, you were saved. Won't the miracle of heaven be three things? One, that we're there. Two, all the people that we didn't think that are there, that actually are there. Three, some of the people that see us and can't believe that we're there. It's true. It's true. No, not that guy. He cut me off in traffic. Not that guy. He's a loser to me on the phone. I remember booking a flight once. Can't be him. Can't be her. The grace of God.